7. That night, sitting at the typer, I poured 2 drinks. I drank 2 drinks, I smoked 3 cigarettes, and listened to Brahms' 3rd on the radio, and then I realized that I needed something to help me get into the screenplay. I punched Pinchot's number. He was in. "Hello? John, it's Hank." "Hank, how are you?" "Fine. Listen, I'll take the 10. "But you said it might hinder your creative process to take it in advance." "I've changed my mind. There hasn't been a creative process." "You mean..." "I mean, I've worked it out in my mind, but there is nothing yet on paper." "What do you have in mind?" "It's about a drunk. He just sits on this bar stool night and day. Do you think the people would care about such a man?" "Listen, John, if I worried about what the people cared about, I'd never write anything." "All right, should I bring the check over to you?" "No, just put it in the mail. No, just put it in the mail. Tonight, thank you." "Thank you," said John. I walked over to the typewriter and sat down. It worked right away. I typed, "The drunk with the blue and yellow soul. Exterior, interior, Dandy's Bar, day." The camera pans down from above. It moves slowly through the bar entrance and into the interior bar. A young man sits on a bar stool as if he had been there for eternity. He lifts his glass. I was into it. All you needed was the first line, then everything followed. It was always there. It only needed something to set it running. That bar came back to me. I remembered how you could smell the urinal from wherever you sat. You needed a drink right off to counteract that. And before you went back to that urinal, you needed 4 or 5. And the people of that bar, their bodies and faces and voices came back to me. I was there again. I saw the draft beer again in that thin glass flared at the top. The white foam looking at you, bubbling just a bit. The beer was green, and after the first gulp, about a fourth of the glass, you inhaled, held your breath, and you were started. The morning bartender was a good man. The dialogue came and took care of itself. I typed on and on. I typed on and on. Then the phone rang. It was long distance. It was my agent and translator from Germany, Karl Vossner. Karl loved to talk the way he thought hip Americans talked. "Hey, motherfucker, how you doing?" "All right, Karl. You still riding your joystick?" "Yeah, my ceiling is riddled with flakes of dry sperm." "Good man." "Thanks, baby. I learn all the good things from you. But, baby, I got good news. You want to hear, motherfucker?" "Oh, yeah, yeah, baby." "Well, besides whistling Dixie out of my asshole, I've translated 3 of your books. Poems, The Lice of Doom, short stories, Cesspool Dreams, and your novel, Central Station Arson. I owe you my left ball, Karl." "Okay, send it airmail. But baby, there's more." "Okay, tell me." "Well, we had a book fair here last month, and I met with the 6 biggest publishers in Germany, and let me tell you, they are hot for your body." "My body?" "Your body of work, you know. Dig?" "I dig, baby. I got these 6 big publishers in a hotel room. I laid out the beer and the wine and the cheese and the nuts. Then I told them it would be open bidding for the advance on the 3 books. They just laughed and got into the booze. I had those assholes playing right into our hand. You are a hot number and they know it. And they know it. I told a few jokes to get them loose. Then the bidding started. Well, to get to the short hairs, Krumpf made the largest bid. I had the motherfucker sign a contract. Then we all hung one on together. All of us assholes got stinko, Krumpf especially, so we scored. We're in like Flynn. You're one cool dude, Karl. Where's my cut? What's my cut? Baby, it should amount to around 35 grand. I'll wire it to you within a week. Man, oh man, that's really rowdy. It beats blowing glass, motherfucker. And how, baby? Hey, Karl, you ever heard this one? What's the difference between a chicken's asshole and a rabbit's asshole? No, what's the difference? Ask little dick. I got it. Far out. With that, our conversation was over. Within an hour, I was $45,000 richer. 30 years of starvation and rejection were starting to kick in. I walked back to the typer, poured a good tall drink, belted that, poured another. I found 3/4 of a stale cigar, lit it. Shostakovich's Fifth was on the radio. I hit the typer. The bartender, Luke, leans forward over bar, eyeing the young man. Luke, listen, you're in this place night and day. All you do is sit and suck up the booze. Young man, yep. Luke, okay, look, I don't mean to hurt your feelings or nothing, but like maybe this shit don't lead nowhere. Young man, that's all right, Luke, don't worry about me. Just keep them coming. Luke, sure, kid, but ain't there another part of you somewhere? Young man, hey, Luke, you ever heard this one? What's the difference between a chicken's asshole and a rabbit's asshole? Luke, I don't want to hear no jokes, man. I want to know, isn't there another part of you somewhere? Young man, well, shit, I was in the 6th grade, I think. The teacher asked us to write something about our most moving experience. And I don't mean, like, moving to Denver. Luke, yeah. Young man, anyhow, I wrote about this frog I found in the garden. He had one of his legs caught in a wire fence. He couldn't get away. I got his leg out of the wire fence, but he still wouldn't move. Luke, yawning. Yeah? Young man. So I held him in my lap and talked to him. I told him that I was trapped. That my life was caught in something, too. I talked to him for a long time. At last, he hopped out of my lap and hopped across the lawn and vanished into some brush. And I said to myself that he was the first thing that I had ever missed in my life. Luke, yeah, young man. The teacher read it to the class. Everybody cried. Luke, yeah, so, young man. Well, I thought that someday I might be a writer. Luke, leaning forward. Kid, you're nuts. I decided that it was enough screenplay writing for one night. I just sat by the typer and listened to the music on the radio. I didn't remember going to bed, but in the morning I was there. 8. Vin Marbad came highly recommended by Michael Huntington, my official photographer. Michael snapped me constantly, but so far there had been no large call for these efforts. Marbad was a tax consultant. He arrived one night with his briefcase, a dark little man. I had been drinking. He arrived one night with his briefcase, a dark little man. I had been drinking quietly for some hours, sitting with Sarah while watching a movie on my old black and white TV. He knocked with a rapid dignity, and I let him in, introduced him to Sarah, poured him a wine. Thank you, he said, taking a sip. You know, that here in America, if you don't... Thank you, he said, taking a sip. You know that here in America, if you don't spend money, they are going to take it away. Yeah? What do you want me to do? Put a payment down on a house. Huh? Mortgage payments are tax deductible. Yeah, what else? Yeah, what else? Buy a car. Tax deductible. All of it? No, just some. Let me handle that. What we have to do is build you some tax shelters. Look here. Vin Marbat opened his briefcase and slipped out many sheets of paper. He stood up and came toward me with the papers. Real estate. Here, I've bought some land in Oregon. This is a tax write-off. There are some acres still available. You can get in now. We look for a 23% appreciation each year. In other words, after 4 years, your money is doubled. No, no, please sit back down. What's the matter? I don't want to buy anything that I can't see. I don't want to buy anything that I can't reach out and touch. You mean you don't trust me? I just met you. I have worldwide recommendations. I always go by my instincts. Then Marbad spun back toward the couch where he had left his coat. Left his coat. He slipped into it, and then, with briefcase, he rushed to the door, opened it, was out, closed it. You hurt his feelings, said Sarah. He's just trying to show you some ways to save money. I have two rules. One is never trust a man who smokes a pipe. The other is never trust a man with shiny shoes. He wasn't smoking a pipe. Well, he looks like a pipe smoker. You hurt his feelings. Don't worry. He'll be back. The door flung open, and there was Vin Marbat. He rushed across the room to his original place on the couch, took off his coat again, placed the briefcase at his feet. He looked at me. Michael tells me you play the horses. Well, yeah. My first job when I came here from India was at Hollywood Park. I was a janitor there. You know, the brooms they use to sweep up the discarded tickets? Yeah. Ever notice how wide they are? Yeah, well, that was my idea. Those brooms used to be regular size. I designed the new broom. I went to operations with it, and they put it to use. I moved up into operations, and I've been moving up ever since. I poured him another wine. He took a sip. Listen, do you drink when... Listen, do you drink when you write? Yes, quite a bit. Yeah, yes, quite a bit. That's part of your inspiration. I'll make that tax deductible. Can you do that? Of course. You know, I was the one who began making deductions for gasoline use in the automobile. That was my idea. Son of a bitch, I said. Very interesting, said Sarah. I'll fix it so you won't have to pay any taxes at all, and it will all be legal. Sounds nice. Michael Huntington doesn't pay taxes. Ask him. I believe you. Let's not pay taxes. All right. But you must do what I tell you. First, you put a down payment on a house, then on a car. Get started. Get a good car. Get a new BMW. All right. What do you type on? A manual? Yes. Get an electric. It's tax deductible. I don't know if I can write on an electric. You can pick it up in a couple of days. I mean, I don't know if I can create on an electric. You mean you're afraid to change? Yes, he is, said Sarah. Take the writers of past centuries. They used quill pens. Back then, he would have held on to that quill pen. He would have fought any change. He would have fought any change. I worry too much about my goddamn soul. You change your brands of booze, don't you? Asked Vin. Yeah. Okay, then. I poured the wine around. What we want to do is to make you a corporation so you get all the tax breaks. It sounds awful. I told you, if you don't want to pay taxes, you must do as I say. All I want to do is type. I don't want to carry around a big load. All you do is to appoint a board of directors, a secretary, treasurer, so forth. It's easy. It sounds horrible. Listen, all this sounds like pure shit. Maybe I'd be better off just paying taxes. Maybe I'd be better off just paying taxes. I just don't want anybody bothering me. I don't want a tax man knocking on my door at midnight. I'll even pay extra just to make sure they leave me alone. That's stupid, said Vin. Nobody should ever pay taxes. Why don't you give Vin a chance? He's just trying to help you, said Sarah. Look, I'll mail you the corporation papers. Just read them over and then sign them. You'll see that there's nothing to fear. All this stuff, you see, it gets in the way. I'm working on this screenplay, and I need a clear mind. A screenplay, huh? What's it about? A drunk. Ah, you, huh? Well, there are others. I've got him drinking wine now, said Sarah. He was about dead when I met him. Scotch, beer, vodka, gin, ale. I've been a consultant for Darby Evans for some years now. You heard of him. He's a screenwriter. I don't go to movies. He wrote The Bunny That Hopped Into Heaven, Waffles with Lulu, Terror in the Zoo. He's easily into six figures, and he's a corporation. I didn't answer. He hasn't paid a dime in taxes, and it's all legal. Give Vin a chance, said Sarah. I lifted my glass. All right, shit, here's to it. Attaboy, said Vin. I drained my glass and got up and found another bottle. I got the cork out and poured all around. I let my mind go along with it. You're a wheeler dealer. You're slick. You're slick. Why pay for bombs that mangle helpless children? Drive a BMW. Have a view of the harbor. Vote Republican. Then another thought came to my mind. Are you becoming what you've always hated? And then the answer came. Shit, you don't have any real money anyhow. Why not play around with this thing for laughs? We went on drinking, celebrating something. 9. So there I was, over 65 years old, looking for my first house. I remembered how my father had virtually mortgaged his whole life to buy a house. He had told me, look, I'll pay for one house in my lifetime, and when I die, you'll get that house. And then in your lifetime, you'll pay for a house. And when you die, you'll leave those houses to your son. That'll make two houses. Then your son will... The whole process seemed terribly slow to me. House by house, death by death. 10 generations, 10 houses. Then it would take just one person to gamble all those houses away, or burn them down with a match and then run down the street with his balls in a fruit picker's pail. Now I was looking for a house I really didn't want, and I was going to write a screenplay I really didn't want to write. I was beginning to lose control, and I realized it. But I seemed unable to reverse the process. The first realtor we stopped at was in Santa Monica. It was called 22nd Century Housing. Now that was modern. Sarah and I got out of the car and walked in. There was a young fellow at the desk, bow tie, nice striped shirt, red suspenders. He looked hip. He was shuffling papers at his desk. He stopped and looked up. "Can I help you?" "We want to buy a house," I said. The young fellow just turned his head to one side and kept looking away. A minute went past. 2 minutes. "Let's go." "Let's go," I said to Sarah. We got back into the car and I started the engine. "What was that all about?" Sarah asked. "He didn't want to do business with us. He took a reading and he thought we were indigent, worthless. He thought we would waste his time. But it's not true. Maybe not. But the whole thing made me feel as if I was covered with slime. I drove the car along, hardly knowing where I was going. Somehow, that had hurt. Of course, I was hungover and I needed a shave, and I always wore clothing that somehow didn't seem to fit me quite right, and maybe all the years of poverty had just given me a certain look. But I didn't think it was wise to judge a man from the outside like that. I would much rather judge a man on the way he acted and spoke. Christ, I laughed. Maybe nobody will sell us a house. The man was a fool, said Sarah. 22nd Century Housing is one of the largest real estate chains in the state. The man was a fool, Sarah repeated. I still felt diminished. Maybe I was a jerk-off of some kind. All I knew how to do was to type, sometimes. There we were in a hilly area, driving along. "Where are we?" I asked. "Topanga Canyon," Sarah answered. "This place looks fucked." "It's all right, except for floods and fires and burned-out neo-hippie types. Then I saw the sign, Ape's Haven. It was a bar. I pulled up alongside and we got out. There was a cluster of bikes outside, sometimes called hogs. We went in. It was damn near full. Fellows in leather jackets. Fellows wearing dirty scarves. Some of the fellows had scabs on their faces. Others had beards that didn't grow quite right. Most of the eyes were pale blue and round and listless. They sat very still, as if they had been there for weeks. We found a couple of stools. 2 beers, I said. Anything in a bottle. The barkeep trotted off. The beers came back, and Sarah and I had a hit. Then I noticed a face thrust forward along the bar, looking at us. It was a very fat, round face, a touch imbecilic. It was a young man, and his hair and his beard were a dirty red, but his eyebrows were pure white. His lower lip hung down as if an invisible weight were pulling at it. The lip was twisted, and you saw the inner lip, and it was wet, and it shimmered. "Chinaski," he said. "Son of a bitch, it's Chinaski." I gave a small wave, then looked straight ahead. "One of my readers," I said to Sarah. Oh, she said. "Chinaski," I heard a voice to my right. "Chinaski," I heard another voice. A whiskey appeared before me. I lifted it. "Thank you, fellows," and "thank you, fellows," and I knocked it off. "Go easy," said Sarah. "You know how you are. We'll never get out of here." The bartender brought another whiskey. He was a little guy with dark red blotches all over his face. He looked meaner than anybody in there. He just stood there staring at me. Chinaski, he said, the world's greatest writer. If you insist, I said, and raised the glass of whiskey. Then I passed it to Sarah, who knocked it off. She gave a little cough and set the glass down. I only drank that to help save you. Then there was a little group gathering slowly behind us. Chinaski, Chinaski, motherfuck, I've read all your books, all your books. I can kick your ass, Chinaski. There was something totally missing in the poor fellows, and something in me wrenched for just a moment, and I felt like throwing my arms around them, consoling and embracing them like some Dostoevsky. But I knew that would finally lead nowhere except to ridicule and humiliation for myself and for them. The world had somehow gone too far, and spontaneous kindness could never be so easy. It was something we would all have to work for once again. And they followed us out. Chinaski, Chinaski, who's your beautiful lady? You don't deserve her, man. Chinaski, come on, stay with us. Stay and drink with us. Be a good guy. Be like you're writing, Chinaski. Don't be a prick. They were right, of course. We got in the car and I started the engine and we drove slowly through them as they crowded around us, slowly giving way, some of them blowing kisses, some of them giving me the finger, a few beating on the windows. We got through. We made it to the road and drove along. So, said Sarah, those are your readers? That's most of them, I think. Don't any intelligent people read you? I hope so. We kept driving along, not saying anything. Then Sarah asked, what are you thinking about? Dennis Body. Dennis Body? Who's that? He was my only friend in grammar school. I wonder whatever happened to him. 10. As we drove along, I saw it. Rainbow Realty. I pulled up in front. The parking area was not paved, and there were large potholes and ruts everywhere. I located the flattest surface, then parked. We got out and walked to the office. The door was open, and a fat, dirty white chicken sat there. I nudged it with my foot. It stood up, emitted a bit of matter, and walked into the office. Found a place in the corner and sat down again. There was a lady at the desk, mid-40s, thin with straight mud-colored hair embossed with a paper flower, red. She was drinking a beer and smoking a Pall Mall.
Shit, howdy, she greeted us. Looking for a place, roundabouts?
You might say, I answered.
Well, say it then, ha ha ha.
She knocked her beer off, handed me a card. Rainbow Realty. Indeed, I got what you need. Lila Gant, at your service. Lila stood up.
Follow me.
She didn't lock the office. She got into her car. It was a 62 Comet, I knew because I once had a 62 Comet. In fact, it looked like the same one I had sold for junk. We followed her up a rural winding dirt road. We drove for some minutes. I noted the absence of streetlights. Also, on each side of the road were deep canyons. I made a note that driving along there at night with a few drinks in you could be hazardous. Finally, we pulled up in front of an unpainted wooden house. Well, it had been painted once, a long time ago, but the weather had worn away almost all the paint that had been a hen-shit white to begin with. The house seemed to sag forward and to the left. Our left, as we got out of the car. It was a big house. Looked homey, earthy. All of this, I thought, because I've accepted in advance to write a screenplay and because I've got a tax consultant. We walked up on the porch and the boards, of course, sagged under our weight. Sagged under our weight. I scaled in at 228, most of it fat instead of muscle. My fighting days were over. To think I had once weighed 144 pounds on a 6-foot frame. The grand old starving days when I was writing the good stuff. Lila beat on the front door. Darlene, honey, you decent? You better be because our butts are... Darlene, honey, you decent? You better be because our butts are... Because our butts are coming in. Got some folks who want to see your castle, ha ha ha. You better be because our butts are coming in. Got some folks who want to see your castle, ha ha ha. Lila pushed the door open and we walked in. It was dark inside, and it smelled like there was a turkey burning in the oven. Also, there was the feeling of shadowy winged creatures floating about. A light bulb hung down from a cord. The insulation had peeled away, and you could see the bare wire. I felt something like a cold wind at the back of my neck. Then I realized it was only a rush of fear. I shook that idea off with the thought, this place has got to be really cheap. Then Darlene emerged from the darkness, big lipstick mouth, hair in all directions, eyes gushing kindness to cover up years of waste. She was fat in blue jeans and faded flower blouse. Two earrings like eyeballs, they hung there, swinging a bit. Those blue irises. She was holding a rolled joint. She rushed forward. Lila, you chippy. Lila, you chippy, what's hanging? Lila took the joint from Darlene's hand, took a drag, handed it back. How's your old peg-legged fool of a brother, Willie? Oh, shit, he just got thrown in county jail. He's scared shitless, they're gonna get him in the ass. Don't worry, honey, he's too hog ugly. You really think so? Really? I hope so. Then we were introduced around. Then there was silence. We stood there as if we had lost all power of thought of what we were about. I rather liked it. I thought, well, this is all right. I can stand around here as long as anybody. I concentrated on the twisted wire of the light bulb cord. A tall, thin man slowly entered. He walked toward us, one stiff leg at a time. He put one leg forward and then deliberately followed it with the other. He was like a blind man without a cane. He came toward us. His face was a mass of beard, and the thick hair was twisted, tangled. But he had beautiful eyes. A dark, dark green, emeralds for eyes. The sucker was worth something. And he had a big smile. He walked closer, stopped, and kept smiling, smiling. This is my husband, said Darlene. This is double quartet. He nodded. Sarah and I nodded back. Lila leaned toward me, whispered. They both used to be in the movie business. Sarah was getting tired of the time all this took. Well, let's have a look at the place. Why, sure, honey, you all bring your ass and follow me. We followed Lila into the other room, and as we did, I glanced back. I saw double quartet take the joint from Darlene and have a drag. Jesus, he had such great eyes. Eyes are truly the reflection of the soul. But damn, that big, big smile ruined it all. We were evidently in the dining room or the front room. There was no furniture. There was an empty waterbed nailed to one of the walls, and across the waterbed, scrawled in red paint, was "The Spider Sings Alone." Look at this, Lila said. Look at that yard. Some nice land. We looked out of the window. The yard was like the road, only more so. Large potholes, neglected mounds of dirt and rock. And out there, sitting all by itself, upright, was a lone, discarded toilet. The lid was missing. That's nice, I said, kind of odd. And these here people are artists, said our realtor. We stepped back. I touched the curtain and covered the window. Where I touched it, a piece of the curtain dropped away. These here people are deep inside, said Lila. They just don't bother with the ordinaries, you know. We went upstairs, and the stairway was solid, strangely so. It was good and true, and I felt a little better then, walking up there. All that there was in the room was a water bed, but this one was full. It sat in the far corner, lonely by itself. One strange thing, there was a large swelling at one edge. It gave the impression of an explosion to come. The bathroom was tiled, but the floor had gone unwashed for so long that the tiles had almost disappeared in the smear of dirt and footprints. The toilet was brown-crusted forever. No ever changing that. There was crust upon crust upon crust. It was worse than any toilet I'd ever seen in any dive, in any bar I'd ever been in, and I began to gag at the memory of all those crappers and at the thought of this one here. I walked out for a moment, steadied myself, inhaled, made up my mind not to think about any of it, and then re-entered the bathroom. Sorry, I said. Lila understood. Shit, Parge, he said. It's all right. I didn't look in the bathtub, but did note that somebody had scrawled with various colored paints on the wall over the bathtub. If Tim Leary ain't God, then God is dead. My father died in the Abraham Lincoln Brigade, and the devil as a pussy. Charles Lindbergh was a cocksucker. There were a few other messages painted here and there, but they were smeared and garbled and difficult to read. I'm gonna let you two wander about, you know, so you can get the feel. Buying a home is a real head shaker. I don't want to rush you none. Then Lila left. We heard her going down the stairway. Sarah and I stepped out into the hallway. Hanging near us from a frayed rope was an old rusted coffee pot. Oh my God, Sarah said suddenly. My God! What is it? I've seen photos of this house before. I remember now. I thought it looked familiar. What is it? This is one of the houses where Charles Manson killed somebody. Are you sure? Yes. Let's get out of here. We went on down the stairway. They were waiting for us down there, Lila, Darlene, and Double Quartet. Well, asked Lila, what do you think? I've got your card with your phone number, I told her. We can get in touch. If you people are artists, said Darlene, we can knock some off the price. We like artists. Are you artists? No, I said. Well, I'm not anyhow. I can show you some more places, said Lila. No, said Sarah. We've seen enough today. We have to rest up. We had to push past them, and all the time, Double Quartet just kept smiling.